What you gonna do, brother, when Jeff Townsend Media runs wild on you?
America Stories. All right, all right, all right. Welcome to yet another fantastic, superb, stupendous episode of America Stories. I'm Jeff Townsend. Joining me are Luke and Jock, apparently. So every week you can't really see, but he gets cute and he changes his name to something different here on the recording. So you don't get to enjoy that, but I think it was Jack O'Lantern last week. I think it was Jack Off the week before. I'm not sure.
Something along those lines.
But anyway, nevertheless, guys, we are like, what is this, the ninth episode? Yeah, I think I dropped something on the Delphi case. But yeah, it's the ninth episode of America Stories. It's kind of crazy how far we've come.
Yeah, it is. It's like that song, "Let's See How Far We Come."
Good song. What do you think, Jock?
It's a famous song.
So yeah, wow. You can check out the podcast, of course. We'll go ahead and get an early plug in, americastories.us. And like I said, we're 8 episodes in, going on the 9th now, so check out the previous episodes. We're kind of going in order through American history here. We're doing this in a fun, lighthearted manner, and I think it's interesting stuff, too. I think if you don't even need history class if you just listen to this podcast, so American history is not needed. We'll just cover you.
Yeah, we've got you.
I guess we didn't start off at the very, 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 very beginning, but nevertheless, we did start off with right before the Revolutionary War, and we're working our way through it now. What did we do last episode, guys? Was it the
end of the Siege of Boston?
That's what we did. So every couple episodes, we kind of break off and we do a little bit more detail on things. And that's kind of what you guys had in mind for today's recording?
Yes. We wanted to speak about, we always hear about the grand, figures of the time, the Washingtons and the Adams and the like, but not enough time has ever spent on the regular soldiers at the time.
We focus on the big dogs, is what you're saying. We got to focus on the little people.
The little dogs.
Little dogs are important.
These were people who were on the front lines. These were people who were dying for this cause.
Right.
And they definitely deserve their due. But it's interesting to know, what was the day-to-day life of one of these soldiers when they weren't fighting? So the average revolutionary soldier in the Colonial Army at the start of the war was enlistment of about 6 months, so which was not a lot of time to train and then, deploy. And so we talked about that in the last episode. We talked about towards the end of winter, Washington was worried about a lot of these enlistments coming up because these soldiers were on short term. Shortly after that, they began raising the terms of how long you were enlisted, and it ended up being up to 3 years.
Did they not think it was going to be... I'm just trying to think how they came up with the number to begin with. And I get they extended it later, but they just think this is going to be like a short-term thing.
So that's actually a good question. And I believe that a lot of people at the time were just assuming that this was going to be resolved diplomatically still. And so they just were like, well, we see it hold at this level of troops for a while. And then later we'll after we discuss things, we won't need them anymore.
That 6 months is still a long time. Don't get me wrong. I mean, that's still a really long time when you're doing that every day.
Yeah. And like I said, by the end of it, they had expanded it up to 3 years. The way they got people to agree to enlist for that length of time is they promised everyone 100 acres of land when they finish their enlistments.
That was a big thing back then, right? Everybody wanted property.
Yeah. I mean, it's still technically a big thing now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But
I'm not sure I would go to fight a war for 3 years, though, for some property.
That's true. Yeah.
Still, though, it's like the They can't pay him money. So what you're saying is they may not be able to, like, what they couldn't pay in funds, they might make up for in assets, and that assets being acres of land.
Exactly, yeah. They could pay them a moderate amount of cash, but they knew that the real way to bring them in would be the land at the end. The soldiers' pay was around $6.35 a month, which equals to be about $1,300 in today's dollars.
Not a substantial amount in today's money either, really.
No, not really, no. Especially because they had to buy their own equipment and uniform.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, all their musket balls and everything, they had to pay for themselves out of pocket. So obviously, there wasn't a lot of cash to go around. They did get food when they're in camp. They were given about a pound and a half of beef per day, and that was supplemented with a pound of bread or 1.5 pounds of flour. You had a choice there. But the beef, that also counted the weight of the bone, fat, and cartilage. So it wasn't all just meat. It was, you know, kind of the scrap parts of the beef that they gave them almost.
Were they just going to eat the flour? Or, like, I'm trying to figure out, it was like either or?
So they would usually make a meal with it. They would sometimes make a porridge, like a flour porridge, or they would make a pancake. What they would like to do at the time was mix a little bit of water, flour, salt, and some of the beef fat into a pancake. And then they would cook that up on a board, which I think was called a bannock board. And then that would be cooked up next to the fire. If they didn't have a bannock board, they would usually cook it on a spade or even sometimes just straight on a stone in the ash.
Yeah, spade. And cool. To like the extent of them also buying their own equipment and like bullets and things, some of them would probably also bring along other types of, you know, herbs or spices or something like that. That's something dry that they could put with the food. So, you know, we see a lot of stories about military people who would make stews with the meat and then maybe add flour to thicken it, things like that. And then whatever flavoring they could add to it along with the meal.
What if they're like selling this stuff to each other? You know, like,
oh, I'm sure there was some trading because there were some other conditions for other people outside of the military to get rations. And so you can imagine that there would have been trading if someone wanted more beef or more bread, depending on what type of stew they were trying to make.
Or maybe summer sausage. I got to mention summer sausage in every episode somehow.
I mean, it's so good.
Seems like something you can carry in your bag, you know, and as you're going,
summer sausage,
just take a bite out of it and put it back in there.
Some kind of jerky.
Yeah, exactly.
They were also given a daily ration of about 2 to 3 ounces of hard spirits. That was to go into your canteen of water that you would get usually from a creek. And at the time, they didn't really know what they were exactly why, because bacteria wasn't really a known thing at the time. But they knew that it made it more palatable and usually less sickness was spread afterwards.
You think they called it a creek or a crick?
I would say crick.
For sure. Jock, what would you have your money on?
I still call it a crick, so I hope they call it a crick.
So yeah, they didn't really, I guess I didn't think about that. Obviously, it's not good just to drink straight out of the crick. But you got to do what you got to do, right?
Yeah, they did also boil water in the camp. But if you were out in the field training, you would drink it out of a canteen. And so you would definitely want that alcohol in there to at least somewhat purify it.
I gotcha. So it's not to get a little bit of a kick, if you know what I mean. It's to sterilize the creek water or lake water or whatever the heck they were doing to use. Okay. Does that actually work?
Well, it did somewhat. It's actually why people drank so much beer back in the day, because beer was easier to drink once it had a little bit of fermentation. They would make what's called small beers, and it would have like 1 ounce or 1% or 2% alcohol, and that would be enough to kill off the bacteria and make it so you didn't get dehydrated and hungover still.
We didn't mean to bring small beers back.
I agree. Small beers is actually something that they would make in each household. Like, you didn't have to necessarily be a brewer or have like a brewery to make small beer. You just kind of did it in like a bowl in your house or a jug or something like that.
Wow.
Yeah, it was definitely a part that was very common in day-to-day life. So they really knew how to do it.
Did they get this from, where did they get this from? Is this like a tradition that was practiced around the world or?
Yeah, pretty much. It was practiced everywhere at the time because it was a known thing. They didn't know, like I said, they didn't have the science of the bacteria, but they knew that this would.
Yeah, you knew you'd get the shits if you just drank it straight out of the creek is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yeah, something along those lines. They also, while they didn't necessarily know about the bacteria, they didn't know that they needed to preserve it, right? They had to take action to make sure either food or drink would go bad. So that's why they would like pickle or brine like meats in like casks and jars, things like that. They would put like a lot of salt and salt water to preserve the meat longer. And then they probably just are like, well, let's preserve the water longer so it doesn't have whatever it is that's causing it to go bad.
The day-to-day of the soldiers were almost entirely taken up with drills regarding musket and bayonet practice, as well as building forts and digging latrines. Latrines at the time were actually called vaults. I actually don't know why, but it changed over the years, but vaults is what they were called. And the vault was basically a hole that they dug out with a slit over the top that they put on there with wood, and that would act as their latrine.
Vault. Interesting. So you said bayonet, right? When they first started, they didn't, this wasn't like a common American practice, right? This was something that was adapted?
Yes. When they originally, they did not have bayonets, but shortly after the Battle of Boston, the bayonets became bayonet practice, and having them was more widespread. They definitely knew that they needed them after Bunker Hill, and they just flat out produced them to get them in time. A day of drilling would last 8 hours solid, regardless of weather. You didn't have time to eat during that time. You would just basically be drilling the entire time. At night is when you would break again for food. Every group of men was an 8-man squad that they called a mess. You all cooked together. Everyone worked together to make their meals. And that's why they would, a lot of times, would take flour, because then they can make a bigger meal with a pound and a half of flour as opposed to a pound of bread. So somebody would be in charge of making the cakes while someone cooked all the meat. As we said earlier, the campfire cakes was another word for it, but the pancakes that they made was really popular. And like Jack brought up, if you're lucky, someone bought some spices to add to all this. Otherwise, you had a very bland meal compared to what we know today, obviously. The other thing they loved doing at night is they played games. And I found this really interesting researching this. I was like, what kind of games were popular then? So there were two that were the most popular in camp.
Can we guess these real quick before?
Yeah, please.
I'm going to guess first. Hide and seek and duck, duck, goose.
That's exactly what I was going to say. No, I was going to say something like dice or something. I don't know.
One of the two games was a dice game. It was called Hazard. And it was basically an early form of craps, but strangely more difficult than craps. I don't know how to play craps. And every time I try to read how to play it, I get a headache. And apparently Hazard is a more complicated form of that.
I'm surprised they didn't call it vaults.
You know, if they would have played Duck, Duck, Goose, they could have also had some of their training in.
Yeah, like hiding from the enemy.
Running around, I guess.
Yeah, there's a strategy to Duck, Duck, Goose.
There is.
You know, it's a mental and a physical aspect. So
it's a psychological game more than anything.
So they played craps, and what was the other one?
The other one was a game called Whist. Spelled Whist. If you played euchre ever, it's essentially euchre.
It's
a trick-taking card game. The only major difference between Whist and euchre is you use every card in the deck as opposed to just the was it 9 through ace, and use all of them in whist. Also, you have a hand of 13.
Are we going to skip over the fact that your family used to play so much euchre? And I never once learned how to play that, luckily.
We played euchre multiple times a night. Actually, I think one of our brothers was in, you know how some schools have like a chess team? He was a part of like a euchre team.
I think he made that up.
Honestly, he may have. He told me this once, but I never followed up. So I don't
know. But it is a big thing in your family. It is a big thing. And I just don't have the attention span to play cards at all. That's why I said that. But euchre is a big thing. So
yeah.
I'm sure you read that, Luke, and you got a little heartwarming feeling of that.
I mean, it's a fantastic card game. It's kind of like, you know, Rummy, you know, if you ever played Gin Rummy or anything like that.
I've only heard of those games.
The thing is, you thought it was actually called Lucre when you first started playing it. So that's why you liked it so much.
Yeah, absolutely why. So day-to-day life in the camp was kept under control with really strict punishments. Actually, to a point that I wanted to do this whole episode based on one of these punishments. But anyway, so like small infractions such as like shirking your daily duty and chores, you were punished with a caning in front of everybody. Yeah.
Is this like something that George Washington brought to the table?
He was a fan of keeping morale or keeping people in check.
Morale low.
Strict.
Morale. He was a fan of keeping people in check.
Okay, all right. Yeah, keeping people in check with punishments. But larger infractions would end in a public execution.
Whoa. Things just got
okay, so look,
fast.
Gotta give me an example. Like, because a caning's pretty bad. What would be a large, what would you have to do to make that large category?
I'm glad you asked. Because this is the reason why I brought this all up. So if you did not use a vault when you defecated, believe it or not, straight to execution.
Like, what would you do to alternative to that?
If you just defecated on the ground.
And what if you went to the woods?
If they caught you, it'd be execution.
So the old question is, you know, does a bear do that in the woods? Well, a colonial soldier does.
We've got standards. You're going to shit in this hole.
That is basically yes. When I read that, I was like, what? But then I thought about it, and there's a reason behind it. And it was prevent disease and sickness and anything getting into the groundwater or the river water. Because of all the soldiers that died during the war, only 10% died from battle. The rest died from disease, sickness, and infection.
And definitely believable for that.
Crazy, right? Like this is what will get you killed. But that's what they did.
So there's documented cases of this happening?
Yeah, they did, yeah.
You think John Brown would have defecated on the ground in
Out
protest?
Of principle, I'm sure he would have.
Yeah.
He would have gotten away with it, though. I mean, he's John Brown.
Man, let me dive in deeper to this vault.
Yeah,
sounds like a terrible place. So how did you... Okay, so if you're defecating in a vault, which sounds terrible, which is a hole in the ground, basically, that is covered up. So are they going down into the vault to defecate? Are they defecating down, like, into it through an opening?
Yeah, so what they do is they dig out a big cavernish thing, and then they put wood planks across with slits in them. And then you defecate and use the bathroom through that.
So it's like a modern-day porter potty.
Yeah.
So nobody went down inside of the vault.
No, because they would just bury it after it got too full.
And you had to dig another vault. Gotcha. So when you said that earlier, I thought they were like going to use this for like fighting. I guess they're fighting something, but it's not war. So they're okay. I see how you did that there. I thought... I wonder, like, whose job is it to maintain the vault, to make those important decisions on when to bury the vault, to monitor the vault.
I believe what I've read, that was kind of like a camp shared duty. Basically, if you saw that it was full, you and your mess of guys would cover it and then start digging the next one.
You're on vault duty tonight, boys.
So it's kind of like, you know, when the trash needs to be taken out and everyone stacks up as much as they can to avoid taking, you don't want to take it out.
I would be concerned, like that moment when we cover up the previous vault and we don't have another one. And like, what if you got to go? You know,
how many vaults do they have ahead of time?
Dig that vault fast because your life is on the line.
I believe they dug out several at a time.
So they're really using several at a time, or is it only one? This is a lot of questions.
They would dig a few. So I would assume they would have a few.
So maybe like the group that you're mentioning had their own vault.
I don't believe it was just that few amount of people, but it was probably one for every like 50 or so people.
Public restrooms. Yeah, I might dig my own vault.
That was daily life in a camp for a soldier, but they were always in a camp. And they, when they were on the march, they had to take everything that they needed with them, obviously. So when you were on the march for a day, which would be about 8 hours every day, you'd be carrying about 45 pounds of gear. That would be your rifle, your bullets and powder, rations, mess kit, canteen, blankets, and stuff like that. On your back, and it's a very uncomfortable, you know, bulky and knapsack that you would have, and it would, be just a kind of a horrible situation marching that long. And then on top of all that, the food that you had while you were marching was even less appealing than what you had in camp. Instead of bread, you would have hardtack, which is a dry cracker kind of thing. Like, I don't know if you've ever seen it, but it is so hard that it could actually break your teeth. What they would do is they would put that into their canteens, let it soak up the water so they could kind of like slurp it down and drink it over time. Or they would boil it at night and make like a porridge out of it. The other thing they would get instead of, you know, the fresh beef was dried beef or pemmican, which is dried beef that's stored inside of fat.
Yeah. Let's go back to the million-dollar question of the defecating. Because there are a lot of people listening to – there are several – I'm surprised with the number of people who listen to this podcast, and I feel like I got to do them justice. And feel free to contact me if you are just as curious as I am. What were the rules of defecating on the go? Were you able to find that in your hours and hours, hundreds of hours of research of defecating?
So they would dig a kind of a quick, short vault. Like it would be like smaller, not as deep, so they don't have to. It would just be at the end of the day or beginning of the day. They would dig out a quick trench and you would use that and then bury it.
So they took bathroom breaks?
Yeah.
What happens if you... you ate some bad dry beef and whatever that other thing you said was, can't remember now, and you really had to go. You just got to hold it in.
So there was a lot of people who I believe I read a few times of people who had to break away and sneak away and dig a hole and do it themselves real fast. And they had to get back in line before anyone noticed. But these were just like passing mentions, so I don't know how often it happened. I'm sure it happened pretty often. But yeah, basically you would just try to sneak away while your lieutenant wasn't looking and dig a hole and go.
Man, this sounds terrible. So they didn't carry in shovels, were they? I mean, everybody didn't have their shovel or something? Like
a lot of times you would have some sort of entrenching tool. It would be like some sort of little shovel.
Sounds like a noisy thing to do to use the bathroom.
But you got a whole company of guys with like frying pans on their back walking, making clanging noises. You probably won't get hurt.
This is it's a matter of life or death. I think Jock said it best.
Yeah. Yeah. And I would be like, I would cover for people. I'd be like, oh yeah, he definitely he definitely dug a hole. He definitely made a hole.
Digging a hole. I watched him the whole time. You'd have to look out for each other.
Yeah. You would have to be a really kind of horrible person to just like turn someone in.
Yeah. Can you imagine that? Benedict Arnold would have definitely turned somebody in.
He probably would have. Yeah.
Benedict. I'm not going to lie. Ever since you brought up this, I haven't heard anything else. I just keep thinking about how terrible this is.
It is. It is. It's like a...
But I get it. It's a matter of personal hygiene, which is important. But man, like, this is like, these are stricter rules than like just going hunting in the woods.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just actually, like I said, it's 100% why I was like, oh, this is the episode we're doing this week. We'll talk about this because I found out this fact.
Jock, you're smiling really big. What is going through your mind?
You know, other than the audio in sync, the audio in synchronies. Other than that, yeah, I'm just thinking about really glad we have indoor plumbing.
I gotta wonder how much this really is George Washington. Like, he's gonna come in, he's gonna turn things around, he's gonna prioritize the fecal matter of which we're.
Well, what if it was? What if it was like just terrible? What if they were just like rampant and like, what are you guys doing? At least dig a hole.
Yeah, yeah. Like, what was happening before where they had to like make a rule where I will kill you
if you keep doing this, you're done.
Like, what were these guys doing? Just shitting all over each other? Like, this is extreme. I'm gonna
Ben
kill
Franklin.
You.
I was heavily involved with George Washington's reforms of how camps were run, and Ben Franklin was kind of like an early pioneer in terms of hygiene and stuff like that. So.
Did he have syphilis? Never mind. Sorry.
Yeah, that's what they say on The Office is like something like that's a gray topic or something like that. But yeah, it's definitely a he was definitely influencing Washington to, you know, make sure that they were strict on these things. And then I'm sure a lot of this all came from Washington when he took over.
You think he's sending like progress reports back on to Ben Franklin on the cleanliness of the how he's conducting this?
I assume so.
I actually don't know if there's anything like that, but I would actually be curious if there was like some document that specifically stated, like, I don't know, maybe how many people were executed for this. You know, that would be a interesting number to know.
What do you say? Okay, so if you do go as far to execute somebody for this, what do you say to their family?
Oof. That's a good question.
Like, listen, this guy, you do not understand how often this guy would defecate. We had to shoot him.
Like, how could this be accepted? Like, it'd be devastating.
That's a good question. I would like to see the letter home that was written explained why this person was executed. Soldiers, when they were drilling, had to learn how to fire the bullets rapidly. The goal of firing your musket wasn't so much to be accurate, it was to just fire a lot of them. So the number one thing they trained was how fast can you reload and fire again. And you had to get it up to 4 bullets per minute. Some people who are rapid fire, like specialists, they could get up to 5 or so per minute. And that was considered to be amazing. It's interesting now that kind of fire rate would be absurdly slow. But at the time, that was pretty good. Like 4 per minute is crazy.
Is this something that the British was known to be excellent at? Fire rate?
Yes, I believe they were, at the time, were the fastest at reloading and firing again. And that's why they were so great at winning battles, because they could break the enemy lines quickly with just a volley after volley of musket balls.
For those of you listening, I hope you leave these clicking sounds in as possible.
Yes.
Jock is investigating something here.
Yes, my keyword is really, really loud.
Like, you look at world rankings of... muzzleloader reloading?
Sort of. The British musket firing rate was 3 to 4 per minute. So
they're trying to get them up to British standard, basically.
Yeah, British or slightly better.
Yeah.
So in the day-to-day camp life, thing that is not as talked about as much is if you had a family and they lived in the area, you were allowed to have them live with you in camp. And wives were given a half ration, half daily ration, and kids were given a quarter daily ration. The wives could earn another half ration by doing work in the camp as like laundresses or cooks and so on. So this was something that a lot of people liked a lot because they could have their family near them at first anyway. Usually, though, you would march away and you wouldn't have them anymore.
I wonder if this is a... I don't want to hold this up forever, but I know it varies greatly, but how long would they typically stay at a camp, do you think?
So that would obviously depend on whether or not they were planning on campaigning or attacking somewhere. Sometimes, like during the winter, they would hole up almost the entire winter in that camp. Otherwise, they would march after a couple weeks. And obviously, certain areas where they're under siege, they were there for a while.
You got anything else, or I'll just keep asking. I have a lot of questions, so I'll let you do what you're doing.
So there is one other thing. It has to do with the women in the camp. Washington was strict about another thing. He made sure that there were no prostitutes allowed anywhere near the camp. If you broke this law, you would have a severe beating.
I mean, compared to his other punishments, I guess that's not so bad.
Wow. I don't know what else to say. It's not as bad as shitting on the ground.
He didn't get executed, I guess.
It was still very strict.
Yeah. Everybody, that's a lot of people to get beat, take a beating.
Yeah, like I said, it was also mostly done in the name of controlling infections and disease. It was, you know, something they had to curtail. They didn't want people coming in that they didn't know. On top of that, they didn't want any, you know, sexually transmitted diseases to happen in the camps. All these things would have cut the ability of the war machine to be able to fight. At this point, there were probably about 12,000 Colonial Army. It never got bigger than 17,000. A total of 170,000 different people had fought in the Army throughout the entire war, but it never got bigger than about 17,000 at any point. And so, like, if you lose, like, 10% to illness, That would totally wreck your ability to fight.
Is it question time? What else do you got?
That's about all I have.
I would like to give a little bit of an update on Abraham Whipple, if we'd like to hear about. Oh. We didn't really go through further in the timeline, I suppose I could say, in the Revolutionary War, but on the topic of food.
I thought you were going to say prostitutes.
Well, Whipple was a wild man. We already know that, but... So just like generically speaking, Navy, I guess the Continental Navy during the Revolutionary War would be fed very similar to most other navies, which is like rations of meat and what they call ship's biscuit, which was basically hardtack. I'm not really sure what the difference between hardtack and ship biscuit, other than to help dry the bread, they would leave it out in the open so that like the salty air would dry it out even more. But they would come up with dishes that they would, they come up with names for the dishes, and some people believe that they're silly sounding just because they wanted to have some fun with it. So some recipes would be called Lobscouse and Dandy Funk. I think Dandy Funk sounds like a very modern, like, jokey name, but apparently they use that. And it was basically just, both of these were kind of like just variations of breaking up the ship biscuit and putting some meat and water and boiling it. But they're a little bit different, but for the most part, it's the same. They just kind of came up with a funny name. So it seems like they were having a little bit more fun on the boats than they were in the barracks or whatever.
They're just setting sail and lighting ships on fires and having all sorts of good time.
Apparently.
That's a good update on Whipple, though. It's question time, right?
Yeah, it's question time.
Yeah. Okay, so this is more of a dark sort of question, I guess. So obviously we talked about death, and that would definitely happen as they went along on these marches to these different camps and just as time passed by. How would they handle a death of somebody, like ritually speaking? Do we know what they would do?
So they would usually do a burial. If they're near a town, you would be buried in the cemetery of that town. And, you know, this was, you know, in the middle of a colony, so a lot of times they were near some sort of village. But if they weren't, they would actually dig like a camp graveyard, which would happen occasionally. There's definitely people who were buried out in the woods when they died on a march. I've seen some journals mention that. So it was more a matter of where location. If you were, like I said, if you had a cemetery nearby within days walking distance, you would probably take them there.
Yeah. This, we talked about the preventative stuff they did, but this still happened. That still occurred, still had disease. Winter was a particularly really brutal time. Going back to what you'd said earlier, so they're kind of supplying their own clothes and all that. I mean, you go into, and they're in places that get really freaking cold. So they're still not supplied clothing, really?
No clothing was supplied. In fact, one man wrote in his journal that during when they were holed up in Valley Forge, his socks had all been like rotten and torn away, and so he had no socks inside his shoes when he was, you know, so went out there in that cold, and that was one of the coldest winters on record at the time. And so, yeah, during all this, if you didn't have the money for clothes saved up, you could seriously freeze to death, and a lot of people did.
Yeah, terrible. So I want to pivot a little bit here. This had to have a big impact because they're going across the country. They're going in these communities. It had to have a, like, first of all, just imagine, like, a shit ton of soldiers setting up camp near your house, near your city. It had to have an economic impact as well, because I'm sure if you needed supplies and stuff like that, you would have to get it at these certain, I'm just going to say cities. I don't know a better way to phrase it. But there had to be an impact on the places they're going to.
Yes, it did have an economic impact. It would be like a caravan of these guys coming in, and they would just buy up all the food or that they wanted extra or clothing. So some towns really enjoyed this because they had a chance to sell some of their excess stuff. Some places hated it because this was going to possibly take away from the townsfolk who needed stuff. So they would raise the prices when these soldiers were incoming. So it really was dependent on the area again, but it could either be a welcome sight or a very unwelcome sight to see the soldiers marching in.
Another thing is like, to think about is this wasn't a whole lot different over the course of history, like before this point, of wherever like armies would be like moving around. Even if you hear or read about like old, like ancient Roman military forces, like moving from city to city or preparing for something or you know, a march or something like that. And they would then arrive in town. They would do very much the same thing. They would buy a bunch of animals, livestock, so they could put it back at the camp. They would buy, any amount of necessities like bowls and cups and clothing and things like that. So as far as like a moving military that would have like money to spend, this was not unheard of.
I wonder how they like got you the money too. Would you're on like if you're on the move, how are you going to get these funds to buy things, you know?
So they didn't always get the money. That was an issue. They would always be like, give you basically an IOU, and you would just have to accept that, and then you would have to hope that later on they would catch you up. And you really didn't have too much of a choice, because if they didn't, if you left, you'd be AWOL and be executed.
It's giving you gotta do what you gotta do, I guess, to keep people there.
I wonder how many people actually would just run away.
A lot. Desertion was a big thing throughout the entire Revolutionary War on both sides, technically, but it definitely happened a lot with the, you know, the colonial army. And, like, you know, there was a lot of backcountry that people could just escape to and hide.
Last question I have. We talked about the illnesses and all that. Do they have a lot of trained medical personnel that were participating in these camps or on the move? Or
you always had what would be the equivalent of a doctor at the time on hand, at least one. They did what they could. Inoculation was a known practice for smallpox, but it was not a socially accepted practice. And so they didn't usually practice inoculation in the camp, even though they really should have, because a lot of people died just from smallpox.
Can you explain what that is?
The way they did it, you would take a bit of the flesh of the person, a person who had smallpox, you would take it from one of the pustules on their body, and then you would slip it into the body of a person who does not have it, by like cutting into their arm and then slipping it up in there with like a stick kind of thing. That would give you a small dose of the virus, which then your body would build antibodies. It did work. It didn't work 100%, but it did work a lot. But it was considered to be somewhat unclean of an action. And so it was not practiced openly, and only certain people who did it, and they were kind of outcast when they found out you did inoculation.
This is something that's talked about a lot, though. You hear about them doing this, so it's kind of like a vaccine with a stick, which
very
I don't see
early,
how that's...
Very early vaccine, basically, yeah.
Yeah, because it didn't work sometimes, you know. Obviously, some people died. Some people just got, you know, they just got it, the fox. And even the people who did survive would probably be, like, permanently scarred wherever the inoculation or whatever you want to call it took place.
You can't crap in the woods, but I'm going to stick a stick in you with... smallpox on it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ugh.
It was very rough.
Oh, man. This has been an interesting episode, though. Obviously focused. I probably never focused on defecating so much in any conversation that I've ever had. But in all seriousness, it was like a way to restore discipline and order. And I guess you could say try to take care of the bigger picture as a whole. I'm stretching here to figure out how to phrase it.
Yeah, that's not too far off. Like, it was, if you absolutely needed this group of people to fight a specific way in order to win, you would do almost anything. And so these strict crackdowns on everyone's practices were the only way that they could think of to keep everyone in line and keep everyone alive.
It was also kind of like the defining difference between the Continental military and, say, something like the Green Mountain Boys, who may have been effective, but they were certainly not very organized. So it's unlikely that they would be able to, like, win the war.
Did they defecate all over that fort, you think?
Oh, sure. I'm sure they did.
I lost thought of what I was going to say originally. I think it's... okay, I got it now. It's important to note, though, like you said, I don't know how long would go between battles or even fights. Like, could be like months and months, right? Without any actual battles. So more than half of the battle was actually survival.
Yeah, actually, because like the siege of Boston, before they actually attacked, after Washington got there, it was another 6 months.
Such a long grind. You literally had to survive in between battles.
Yeah, also what you could forage or farm as an army.
I guess just for me, it's like you really would have to make an extended effort to stay disciplined, stay together, and all that, because you're not just going to battle every day. You really, it's such a bigger process than that's why they focused on a lot of these things.
Yeah, for sure. It's more than just like the adrenaline or whatever that would get you through the moment of a fight, because, you know, that's not going to last for 6 months or 3 years or however long, you know, each individual soldier was supposed to be there. They needed some kind of constant that there was no like walking away from this. They had to really become like a one unit with one purpose kind of thing.
What a conversation. A lot of ups and downs, and it's just crazy to think about how they had to conduct business, I guess, back then, and just how life was back then. We have our challenges in every day, but man, it's just, I can't imagine. And the amount of ground they would cover also while doing this. It's just, it's remarkable. This has been a really interesting conversation, and I'm glad that you guys picked this as an episode. I guess it's something that I really hadn't thought about before. I don't know. I mean, I'm speaking for myself, but
yeah, this was actually a funner one for me to research. I really enjoyed it because, like, it's something that people don't talk about that often. You know, like, you see a million documentaries on History Channel about, you know, the, you know, Washington and everyone else. But, like, when it comes down to the person who's actually doing the fighting, they kind of get glossed over.
Yeah, and, like, the guys running the show in Founding Fathers, Congress, however you want to phrase it, they had probably really no clue what these men were going through. The families, everybody, but they probably didn't have any clue what it was like on the front line, or not to the extent that it was.
Yeah, there's no way.
So they're like, well, we're going to fight with dignity. We're going to follow these standards. We're going to follow these rules. And they have no clue what the conditions were like, and I'm sure how difficult it was to maintain order.
Yeah, and I'm sure that they probably heard some stories, but, you know, like even today, it's difficult to even really comprehend it, even when you hear it. So that's probably, you know, as far as the extent that they got, they may have heard some stories, but that's about as much as it could be. So to actually live that is an entirely different thing.
What a thought-provoking conversation. I hope everybody's enjoyed it as much as I have. I guess just take a few minutes to really think about that and how this come into play. And for me, it's just survival. Just surviving as long as you can was so much of the effort outside of the battle. It's crazy to think about, you know, modern war now. You see these terrible things happening today, a couple different countries. Just the grind of survival internally and just inside that group was insane. So thought-provoking conversation. You guys did a good job picking this one out. We'll go ahead and segue now towards the end. We've been going on here. It's been a good conversation. I appreciate it, guys. If you want to learn more, maybe Jack will get some more information up on americastories.us about the episode. Maybe he can find a couple pictures of bolts.
Yes.
Maybe he can find a couple pictures of the food that I don't even remember, because all I took away from this was the bleakness and then the bolts.
Yeah.
Maybe we can share some of that information. That'd be cool.
Absolutely. I actually have a letter that I feel like we should share on the website from a wife that wrote to her husband that was at war while he was away from the family. It's a longer wet letter, but we should definitely share it on the website.
Yeah, and let us know you people are listening. It's remarkable to listen to three guys just talk U.S. history. Let us know what you think. Get a hold of us. Tell us if you love us. Tell us if you hate Jack. hate his microphone as much as the rest of us do. Let us know. They put a lot of work into researching this. I have to kind of fine-tune the audio, then they edit it out. So it's always good to hear back when you're putting the work in. So again, I appreciate everybody listening, and I'll go ahead and turn it to Jock.
Yes. If you have questions for us, you can message us through our email, which is at 1 second.
I'll say that while you're looking. I've got another challenge for Jack directly.
Okay. Yeah.
Not only does he need to give me episode title and show notes.
Yeah.
I think we need to get a good Facebook page group going, these America Stories. Try to get people suggestions on stuff they want to hear. Kind of like another community to discuss some of this stuff. I think it's something to think about.
Yeah, I agree. So, but in the meantime, they can use the Gmail, which is americastoriespod@gmail.com. And, you know, while we're getting that Facebook page all set up, or they can follow us on Twitter or X, whatever it's called now, at America Story Pod. And you can find us wherever podcasts are found and in our website.
This is the slowest plug ever. The website's americastories.us. Luke, your
Thank
closing
you.
Thoughts. Jock's done for the night.
I like reading about normal people in history. And so, like, I feel like more people need to do that. You need to read more just the big names, more than the name brand Coca-Cola of historical figures, you need to read about some of the little people, and it because it definitely makes you feel more connected with the history.
You got to get connected with the Fagos. You got to get connected with the Kroger,
the RC Cola
drink. RC Cola is a world. Absolutely. Sounds really good. Okay, yeah, I'm going to take us home here. I'm going to send us home packing with what I always say. Until in the meantime, keep being you and keep being great.
Jeff Townsend Media. CG, good night.
And the question is, do I stay here?
Will you be back? Are you going to come back? Will you be back? Are you coming back?